They was treating them, but they couldn't make it.
Under the weather, so my croaky voice, I no, it's not COVID. I tested twice in the last 3 days, so that's okay. And I'm not doing too badly, but my voice is a little weird this morning, so forgive me for that. Jody said she'd get up and take over if I fall over in a little sermon. So this morning we gather with many joys and concerns. Can't let this go by without mentioning the tragedy in Uvalde, Texas. I taught fourth graders. And what a lovely group of human beings fourth graders are, as are they at any age. So we're very sad. I just want to take a moment, and I know each of you has a burden you carry in regards to that event. May we bring it, our hearts, into the heart of God. I was with my daughters the last few days, burning a candle at both ends, I suppose. It was a great joy to be with them. They are still together this morning in Wichita, so that's a very special time. I have waited to mention this, and they're a small and intimate group this morning. So many of you know if you were on session, or but my daughter Cora is almost 7 months pregnant. She didn't want this shared too much because she is no longer with the person who's the father of this child, so she's facing some tough decisions regarding possible adoption if she feels she is not in a place to raise this baby. She just can't make her mind up, but she's well, and I know she will do what's right for this child. So your prayers being with her would be much appreciated. I hope we'll be here to visit sometime soon. Thank you for your thoughts and prayers. This is part of what has been going on over the last few months. That has been difficult at times, but there's a great blessing, and I have no doubt. So we have lots of little grandbabies due this summer. Add Cora to that list. Thank you. Other joys and concerns that you would like to share this morning? So nice to see all the boys back and their mom. Good to have you with us. I'm going to mention something during the children's sermon about Abram and Ruth, but I think we'll save it till then. Patrick. All right, so good to know. Fellowship afterwards, and we hope you all will come. See you there. Get people off the streets for the feast. I wanted to also mention there is a mission team from our presbytery going to Hopkins County, Kentucky in October. Sherry DeHaan is going to make that trip, and anyone is very welcome. If you are interested at all, I have a flyer about it, and you would be most welcome to join the group. And there is the opportunity, if you'd like to make a Pentecost offering, there's an envelope there. We'll also, next Sunday is Pentecost. I invite you to wear red in honor of the Holy Spirit, special day, and we'll look forward to celebrating the dramatic arrival of the Holy Spirit. But let us rise now on the seventh Sunday in Easter and worship the Lord.
Please join me in the call to worship from Revelation 22. said, "See, I am coming soon. My reward is with me, to repay according to everyone's work.
I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end.
Blessed are those who wash their robes, so that they will have the right to the tree of life and may enter the city by the gates.
The Spirit and the bride say, 'Come,' and let everyone who hears say, 'Come,'
and let everyone who is thirsty come.
Let everyone who wishes to drink the water of life as a gift."
The one who testifies to these things says, "Surely I am coming soon."
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with all the saints. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, your Son, Jesus, prayed for his disciples and sent them into the world to proclaim the coming of your kingdom. By your Holy Spirit, hold the church in unity and keep it faithful to your word, so that, breaking bread together, we may be one with Christ in faith and love and service, now and forever. Amen. Please join in singing hymn number 456, "Glorious Things If We Are Spoken."
Thank you.
rejoice over us as the risen Lord of all. Help me fail to honor him. Jesus moves within us through the work of your Spirit, but we fail to respond. Forgive us in our prayers. Keep us in your presence. Guide us by your word. And fill us with your Spirit, so that we may proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, who is risen indeed.
In his name we pray. Amen. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone. A new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Thanks be to God.
Older than you are. I'm 84.
12 times older. Wow. Is Ruth 12 times more precious to Jesus? Do you think?
No. No.
She is to me.
To Roger, yes. But you know what's wonderful is Jesus doesn't measure those things. You are absolutely important to Jesus, Abram and Leo. Elihu, and Deanne, and Beth, and Ruth, and Kathy, and Julie, and Riley. I mean, what is wonderful about our Lord is he doesn't discount anyone, however young or old we are, how much money we make or don't make, whether we get good grades or not. He just loves us and cares about us. So I want us all to leave with that sense of how important we are at age 7 or 4 or 84 to our Lord and our God. So let's pray. You can repeat after me if you'd like. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
That you care for us.
That you care for us.
And you show us how.
And you show us how.
To care for others.
To care for others.
May we do that today.
May we do that today.
Amen.
Amen.
And a deep happy birthday to Abram and Ruth. Tom, are you where you can play a happy birthday for us? Let's sing it a day later.
Loving God, fountain of every blessing, open us to your life-giving word and fill us with your Holy Spirit so that living water may flow through our hearts, a spring of hope for a thirsty world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This morning we will read from Psalm 97 responsibly. I will begin by reading verse 1 and continue with the odd number verses. You will read the even number ones. Listen to this ancient psalm of praise to our wondrous God and join in the song. The Lord is King, let the earth rejoice. Let the many coastlands be glad.
Blessed the darkness from all around you. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of the world.
Fire goes before him and consumes his adversaries on every side.
His light is like a coral, the earth seas and trembles.
The mountains melt like wax before the Lord of all the earth.
The heavens proclaim his righteousness, and all the peoples sing to the Lord.
All servants of images are put to shame. Those who make their boast in worthless idols, all gods bow down before him.
Thine ears and his head, and the towns of Judah rejoice because of your judgments,
O God.
For you, O Lord, are most high over all the earth. You are exalted far above all gods.
You who love the Lord, hate evil. He guards the lives and is faithful. He rescues them from the hand of the wicked.
Light dawns for the righteous, and joy for the upright in heart.
Rejoice in the Lord, O righteous, and give thanks to his holy name.
This morning's gospel reading is from the 17th chapter of John. Jesus is concluding his farewell address to his closest disciples. He prays not only for them, but for all who will believe in him through their witness. It is a cry for unity in and through the Father and Son by the power of the Holy Spirit, a unity of love. I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one. I in them, and you in me, that they may become completely one, so that the world may know that have given me, because you loved me before the foundation of the world. Righteous Father, the world does not know you, but I know you, and these know you that you have sent me. I made your name known to them, and I will make it known, so that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. Holy wisdom, holy word, thanks be to God.
Our reading this morning from the Acts of the Apostles continues the story of Paul's amazing journey into Philippi. We read about him last week, that he met Lydia by the riverside and baptized her and her family. And here is another story of adventure for Paul in Philippi. From Acts chapter 16. One day, as we were going to the place of prayer, we met a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners a great deal of money by fortune-telling. While she followed Paul and us, she would cry out, "These men are slaves of the Most High God, who proclaim to you a way of salvation." She kept doing this for many days, but Paul, very much annoyed, turned and said to the Spirit, "I order you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And it came out of her that very hour. But when her owners saw that their hope of making money was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the authorities. When they had brought him before the magistrates, they said, "These men are disturbing our city. They are Jews and are advocating customs that are not lawful for us Romans to adopt or observe." The crowd joined in attacking them, and the magistrates had them stripped of their clothing and ordered them to be beaten with rods. After they had given them a severe flogging, they threw them into prison and ordered the jailer to keep them securely. Following these instructions, he put them in the innermost cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly there was an earthquake so violent that the foundation of the prison was shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were unfastened. When the jailer woke up and saw the prison doors wide open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, since he supposed that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted in a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." The jailer called for lights, and rushing in, he fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them outside and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They answered, "Believe on the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." They spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. At that same hour of the night, he took them and washed their wounds. Then he and his entire family were baptized without delay. He brought them up into the house and set food before them, and he and his entire household rejoiced that he had become a believer in God. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, and for the word of God within us. Thanks
be to God.
Well, today's reading from the book of Acts struck me as a man's man story right off the pages of True Grit magazine or our mythological American West. Paul, played by John Wayne, or Harrison Ford. Who would it be now? Chris Evans? Ambles down the rootin' tootin' streets of Philippi. All the elements of a Hollywood Western are here. An annoying, loudmouth gal who's been touched by the devil, an angry citizen's arrest by her owners, a quick street trial followed by a brawl and a near lynching. Paul and his sidekick Silas, stripped, beaten, and thrown into the darkest corner of the jailhouse. No palominos or six shooters, but plenty of frontier justice in this no horse town. Down there in that stinking cell, them fool outlaws are singing and mumbling prayers to their God. And by golly, them other no good polecats are actually listening to them. All of a sudden, like, boy, howdy, the grounds are shaking and the keys are rattling and the earth lurches like a bucking bronco. The doors of the cells pop open and them varmint's chains fall to the floor. The poor jailer sees his toast and prepares to fall on his sword when the voice of the Lone Ranger down in the dungeon stops him cold. He hollers up that no one has flown the coop. Terrified out of his wits, the jailer falls to the ground before Kimo Sabe and Silas Tonto, asking what he must do to be saved. He's likely thinking that his life hangs on how much greenback he can rustle up or what revenge he can take on the slave girl's owners. He'd do just about anything to save his skin. But no. The boys only want to tell him a story about a new God, a wondrous tale that speaks truer than grit after the recent events he's witnessed. They simply ask him to listen and believe. Wow, this is too easy. He's so grateful, he brings them to his house and cleans them up. Then Paul and Silas use water to cleanse him of his sins and all his household with him, baptizing them and blessing them in the name of Jesus Christ. With hospitality reminiscent of the Old West, the whole bunch of them sit down with some victuals with lots of singing and rejoicing. The next day, we didn't read this part of the gospel, but Paul announces that he is actually a Roman citizen, and they all get a little quiet. They've been treating him like a foreigner. And the next day, in a show of cowboy pride, Paul demands an official and public apology from the town marshal. Then after a quick stop at Miss Lydia's, he and Silas ride off into the sunset, bound for Thessalonica. My intention here is not to demean this sacred story by retelling it as an episode from Gunsmoke. But I do want to emphasize that this is an action-packed story, like many from the book of Acts, and it may not be everyone's cup of tea. It brings to mind Jerry and my dilemma, and that of many couples trying to select a film they hope to enjoy together. An action-packed adventure may appeal to him, while she might prefer a more nuanced and relational drama. Perhaps it is as a woman, and a mother, and a grandmother, that I have a bone to pick with Paul and the storyteller. We think it's Luke. I'm troubled by the lack of nuance and relational omissions of this tale. As I was preparing this sermon, I kept trying to get over it, but it kept coming back to me and begged for my attention. In the midst of this story of bravado and deliverance, injustice and explosive miracle, arrest and bondage and freedom, I find myself concerned about the girl. You know the girl I mean, a bit player at the beginning of the drama, possessed of a spirit of divination, a demon. She was a great moneymaker for her owners, who charged customers a bundle for the sound of her voice. Some Greeks had their oracle at Delphi. Well, here they might hawk her as the oracle of Philippi. She was likely the city's top tourist attraction, a veritable gold mine, a treasure trove. And it seems she was a thorn in Paul's flesh. He apparently was irritated by her presence in the marketplace. She followed him and Silas through the alleys and stalls, crying out, "These men are slaves of the Most High God who proclaim to you the way of salvation." She spoke the truth. As with the stories of Jesus in the Gospels, demons are often first to recognize the presence of the truly holy. Apparently, Paul finds her a nuisance. Out of annoyance, we read, not compassion, he casts the demon from her. We never hear of her again. The main storyline is recounted in Scripture, and it's all about the men, the good guys and the bad guys, the power brokers. But what about the powerless, the powerless? What about the girl? We only know that she's a slave girl, that her owners have made a lot of money off her demon-possessed spirit, and that they are royally angry about her deliverance. She is likely worthless to them now. What about her? What about the girl? What will become of her now that she can't make money for her masters by telling fortunes? Will her owners find her less palatable ways to turn a profit for them? Does she have a family to go home to? Will she be thrown out on the streets to fend for herself in a hostile world? What strikes me as chilling is that the storyteller doesn't even ask these questions. Does this seem odd to you? What would Jesus do? What does Jesus do when he heals the sick and delivers those possessed by demons? He forms relationships with people. He looks into their eyes. Sometimes he touches them and lets them touch him. He's moved by compassion. He speaks with them and sometimes instructs them as to what they need to do next. He takes the time to stoop low and lift up the woman caught in adultery. He urges the Gerasene demoniac to return to his people in his right mind and to share the story of his healing. He looks for the bleeding woman in the crowd who has touched him in order to speak directly to her and to engage her faith. He clasps the hand of another girl, saying, "Talitha kum," a little girl, arise. And she rises from her deathbed. Then he asks her parents to give her something to eat. Jesus doesn't pass by the little people. He is our champion and savior. Well, there is only one Jesus. At best, the rest of us are Paul's and Lydia's and Mary's, or unnamed girls and boys who owe our life to him. Only in Jesus Christ is God's narrative fully revealed. He is the human being who is also fully aligned with God. We have John to thank for frequently driving this point home. After his resurrection, Jesus says to Philip, "Whoever has seen me has seen the Father." That's what all that "in him, in me, in them" we heard about this morning points us to. Even more amazing, we believers are implicated through the power of the Holy Spirit. God is also in us. The big story, past, present, and future, is bigger than all of us. Jesus in the flesh is gone, and like Mary Magdalene, I have a tendency to want to cling to him. He's ascended into heaven and we're left with Peter and Paul and Silas and Augustine and Constantine and Calvin and Bart and Billy Graham and Pope Francis I. At times over the past 70 some years, I've been pouting, fuming really, angry at God and the boys telling the story the way they have for the past 2,000 years. Like Jonah on the hill above Nineveh, I'm not always thrilled with the storyline or my role in it. But this is God's story, not mine, not yours. Amazingly, we are invited to make it our story too. Sometimes, like Jonah, we are commanded. As we engage and respond to God, the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer of life, we live into God's story. Not perfectly, but God seems to love using even our mistakes, especially our mistakes, for God's holy purposes. Are we listening? Are we answering in word and deed? God's story encompasses our own and changes us as we are willing to participate. This is God's story, not the boys or the girls, not yours or mine. Yet through Jesus Christ, we are each called to participate fully and together in God's saving storyline for humankind and for all creation. The sovereign God grants freedom to Paul and Silas in an earthquake that bursts prison doors and undoes their shackles. God grants freedom to the jailer and his entire household in the cleansing, sin-defying waters of baptism. Yes, and even through Paul's irritability, God grants spiritual freedom to a slave girl who has spent her life dominated by a demon and used by greedy men. Can I trust sovereign God with the future of this girl, with that of my daughters and grandchildren, with someone's transgendered grandchild, another's baby born into poverty, racism, with an addicted brother, with the church's future? What about those 19 children whose brief lives ended in carnage last week? Do I trust God with their tender souls and the futures of their families? What would history answer? What does Scripture reveal? The biggest question among my many questions this morning is this. Individually and as a church, what is my part? What is our part in God's answer today? We have a teacher who shows us the way, who bequeaths us his spirit, that we might actually follow him. Holy Spirit, ready us for the task at hand. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Would rise now in body or spirit, we will sing a lovely little song in our Sing the Faith book, His Eye is on the Sparrow, number 2146.
Should I fear?
Let us pray. We sing for our joy, O God, for your risen Son coming to judge the world. May he who is our righteousness even now foster fairness between nations and between people. We pray for the poor and the desperate, as well as for those who abuse and oppress them, both here and abroad. Comfort those who suffer and chasten those who cause their suffering, that your justice may be known in all the earth. We pray for families, communities torn apart by violence. Pray for Uvalde, Texas right now, for Buffalo, New York, for all those places torn apart by violence and for nations subject to the same thing. Heal broken bones and broken hearts in the broken places and imbue your earth with peace. We pray for the sick, for the elderly, for those recovering from surgery. Bring strength to bodies and souls, new life and energy. We pray for those who are friendless and lonely, for those living with grief or depression. Bring them your friendship and renew their joy, and let us be part of your plan, Lord God. We pray in gratitude for all of our daughters who are with child at this time. We pray for Samantha as she approaches the birth of her baby. We pray for all of our daughters and the grandchildren that we look forward to meeting. Bless and keep them in your care. Keep them healthy and well, and keep their hearts and bodies strong. We pray for ourselves, your church, that we may bear the fruit of peace, hope, and love. Fruit that will last as we learn to trust and follow you, our teacher and friend. Grateful for the Holy Spirit that you pour upon us, bless us with new songs of praise to you. For you do marvelous things. In the name of Jesus, our brother, we pray the old, old prayer that he taught us ever new. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts. We forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We give with glad and generous hearts, that all people may hear God's word and be helped by the work of this church. They might join in with freedom, helping others in Jesus' name, as we rise in body or spirit to sing our doxology of praise.
Thank you.
give thanks to God for our worship together today. As you go forth, remember the little ones, those that are easily forgotten. Make a connection with those that you might see along your path. God's eye is on the sparrow, and our eye can be on the little ones as well, those most in need. And as you go, may the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift the light of his countenance upon you and grant you peace.